Hello everybody, it's Jay Roby. This is a redo of a video that I had earlier that had some problems with it, and I did make a response video to the original video, and I'd like to thank Pest Light and Escapade for pointing out the problems with that one. But this last week here, I've had actually more views on the original video than the redo video, so I figured probably it would be best to take those two videos down and make this one fully updated and fully correct for people to view. Especially as I get new subscribers, they might not catch the response video to the original video that had a problem. And I don't know how many times I can say video in this video, but we're getting up there. So anyway, this chess trick has to deal with quickly calculating king and pawn end games. So in other words, let's say you were playing white in this position. It was white to move. You might try to think of a couple strategies here. For example, you might try to factor out what would happen if you took your bishop and took this pawn. King takes pawn, and then you take the black bishop, because of the way the black bishop is currently positioned, if it gets away, it's going to stop the white pawn, or at least probably force a draw if it gets anywhere along the diagonal to hit the g7 square, which this pawn has to cross. So in a chess match, if you don't know this chess trick, what you're going to end up doing is you're going to end up calculating how many moves it's going to take, and then you're also going to end up calculating, will my pawn make it to the end of the board before the enemy king does? So you'd probably go, okay, one move here, black takes, white takes, black moves king here, and then you would count the squares in your head. And I'm sure if you're really good at doing this, it probably wouldn't take you too long, but there's definitely a shorter way to do it. And I came across this strategy when I was watching Josh Waitzkin's video that he has on the Chessmaster series. And basically what it is to calculate it, you can do it a lot quicker by drawing a diagonal from the pawn up to the 8th rank, so whether you're white or black, and then you create a square. So you just kind of go like this in your head and you create a square all the way to the 8th rank. And if the enemy king is outside this square, either on the side away from the pawn or below the pawn, there is no chance that that enemy king is going to be able to capture your pawn. So your pawn will be able to freely march up and promote. Now obviously if the enemy king would be on the right hand side of the box in this example, or anywhere, as you can see in the highlighted squares, it's going to be able to capture your pawn. We'll go through a couple more examples, but I just want to show you this one first. But it is important to note, if the enemy king on the next move can get into the highlighted area, it will be able to capture that pawn. So let's go through with the line here and see what happens. So bishop takes pawn, king takes bishop, black king moves, and now let's draw the square again. So according to the square here, the black king is outside the highlighted square, so it shouldn't be able to capture the pawn. So white pawn moves, black moves, pawn, king, and it's going to promote, and white is going to have a victory here. So let's take a look at a couple more examples, and we'll go from there. In this example here, we have almost identical setup. The king, however, instead of being on the A file, is now on the B file. And so we'll go through a line here. And so we'll go bishop takes, king recaptures, king takes bishop, and now king moves up to C4. So let's draw the square now and see if the king is inside the highlighted area. So as you can see, the king is in the highlighted area, so it should be able to catch the enemy pawn here. Now this would be, of course, assuming that white would just try to pawn race it and not get its king into a better position. So let's go ahead, it's white to move, white pushes pawn up, king moves, and as you can see, the black king now is going to be able to stop promotion if it was just a straight pawn race to the end. So in this example here, if we go back, since it was black to move and it was able to move into the highlighted square, whether it would have been on the left hand side here or on the bottom, if it can get into this square, the white pawn will not be able to make it to the end on its own, and it will need the help of the white king. Now in this example, we have the white king here on A1, we have the black king on C1, and a white pawn on H3. So the black king will be able to maintain basically a buffer between the white king and reach this pawn. Now, if you were in a chess match under time controls, you might actually take the time and calculate each move to see how the pawn is going to do. Now, let's assume for this example it's black to move. So let's draw our square now. So we draw a diagonal up to the eighth rank, and now we create the box, and we take it to the pawn. And as you can see here, it's a larger box than the last example. And currently, the black king, even though it's black to move, will not be able to get into the highlighted area. So the white pawn should be able to make it to the end on its own. So let's go through it now and see. So black king moves here, white pawn, king, pawn, king. And as you can see, there's nothing this black king is going to be able to do to stop promotion. So let's switch things around here a little bit. Let's move the white king up to a2 and the black king up to c2. And it's still black to move. Now, as a white player, if you draw the square in your head and create the square to the pawn, you will be able to see in this position that the black king, on his next move, will be able to infiltrate the highlighted square and should therefore be able to catch the pawn. So let's go through it. Black king moves, white pawn. And as you can see, the black king is going to be able to stop the pawn and force the draw in this position. So let's take a look at one more example with a few more pieces on the board here. So in this example, let's say it's white to move. Now, as a white player, the first thing that should be crossing your mind right now is a sacrifice to get the bishop off the table to prevent the bishop from at any time hitting the g7 square. And so now, in a normal match, if you weren't aware of this chess trick, you'd probably just calculate everything out. But we can see here, white can take the bishop, king recaptures, so the king is going to be on d2, and you can very quickly draw a square in your head while you're playing the match, and you'll be able to see that there's no way that the black king is going to be able to stop this promotion. In fact, if we were to place the pawn on g3, like so, the same thing will be hold true. So we can mentally think, okay, queen takes bishop, king takes bishop, and then draw the square all the way up to the eighth rank. And you can see here that the king will be outside the highlighted area when that queen is recaptured. So the king shouldn't be able to do anything about it. So let's go through it here. White queen takes, black king captures, and here goes the pawn, racing to the end. And as you can see, the pawn is going to get to the end and promote, and there's nothing black is going to be able to do about it. So it's an interesting chess trick, and it really does cut down on a lot of time when you're factoring in your pawn king races in the end of the match. And you might have one, two, three pieces of material left if you see a kind of a trade line, sacrifice line to clear the material right off the board. You can quickly calculate will your remaining pawn, or you know, whichever side of the board your pawn is on. You always draw, and actually I'm glad I thought about that, you always draw the diagonal, the longest diagonal. So if I, for example, in this last position that we looked at, if this pawn were to be on b3 instead, I would draw my diagonal up to the eighth rank that way. So you always pick the longest diagonal. But it doesn't matter where your pawn is positioned, this will always hold true. So it's a great chess trick, providing, just as a reminder, providing that the black king or white king, if you're playing black, can't get into that highlighted area underneath the pawn or to the far side of the pawn. Once again, if it's on the right-hand side of this pawn or anywhere on the top rank here, the black king is going to be able to capture, unless it's way over here on A8. So it was an interesting trick, and you know, I really wanted to keep this video up, but I wanted to clear things up from my previous videos because I was drawing the boxes a little incorrectly before I was going to the seventh rank. So take care. Hope you enjoy the new video, and we'll see you next time.